Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. I assume you already know that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is on the book of Job. These are lessons we're studying from in the months of October, November, and December of 2016. And this is the lesson number 9 in that series with a sort of an interesting title, Intimations of Hope. What do you suppose that means? Intimations of Hope. Well, stand by, don't go away. Let's see if we can figure it out. We'd like to begin, as we usually do, with a word of prayer. Our kind and wonderful Father, as we now try our best to participate in the situation in which Job found himself there, suffering, sitting on a ash heap, we understand, sores on his all over his body, etc. Could he find hope? Is there any possible reason for hope under those circumstances? We ask especially that you will guide us, you will send your Holy Spirit to lead our discussion, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, in this lesson, we are completing the first cycle of speeches recorded in the book of Job. Now, what do we mean by a cycle of speeches?
Job's alleged friends talked, lectured at him.
Yeah.
And Job speaks. Eventually responded.
Eliphaz responds. Job speaks. Bildad responds. Job speaks. Zophar responds. So that's where we're coming to. Okay. In this lesson, after hearing speeches from each of his three friends, Job had about had it. But at the same time, Job was beginning to see and talk about hope. He realized that he could very easily die at any moment. But he also knew God well enough to state clearly that there is a life beyond this life. He clung to that hope of salvation. Here's an interesting thought from our Sabbath afternoon discussion in the Bible study guide. Man is the only animal, wrote British essayist William Hazlitt, that laughs and weeps, but he is the only animal that is struck with the difference between what things are and what they ought to be. And when I read that, I couldn't help but thinking about my experiences back in Africa, not far from where we lived, in the country of Tanzania. There was an expatriate gentleman who lived there, and he had a small zoo at his place. And in his zoo, he had a hyena that was partially chained. Well, he was chained to a tree, but he was free, and you could walk over there, and this hyena had gotten used to people, and I don't know exactly how they fed him and everything, but he was used to people. And my brother, on one occasion, went over there and put his arm around the hyena and started tickling him. And you've probably heard that hyenas laugh. This creature laughed something. We were in stitches. So, of course, he didn't think it was, I don't think he thought it was funny, but his response to this tickling from my brother was just horrendous. So we're not the only ones who laugh, but maybe we're the only ones who understand what that's all about. Well, the second coming of Jesus Christ pervades the New Testament. I don't think any of us would. I think someone said there's 200 references to the second coming in the New Testament. But anyway, it's everywhere. However, it's not mentioned in the Old Testament. Is that true?
It's not explicitly mentioned in the Old Testament, okay. But certainly the events of the second coming are mentioned. It's just they didn't know it was the second coming. They put it all together as well.
They wanted to put the events, the prophecies about the second coming in the Old Testament, they wanted to mix those up with the prophecies about the first coming. And they were sure that when Jesus showed up, when the Messiah showed up, he was going to wipe out their enemies and give them the glorious kingdom, etc. So they were mixing up first and second coming events.
Probably some of the third, too.
Yeah. Well, if that's our great hope, that Jesus is going to come and save us and take us back to heaven for a period of time and then bring us back to this earth where we can live for the rest of eternity, What hope does the secular atheist or the evolutionist have?
From our perspective.
Don't everybody speak at once.
No, I was just thinking because right now in the United States, one of the leading atheists is doing his level best to get Christianity or to give it thumbs down, and they're taking chaplains out of U.S. Armed Services as we speak. Chaplains have even been kicked out and lost their pension, all because of an atheist with a Jewish name, oddly enough.
Well, where did Job get his ideas about God and the future? There was no Bible, remember? There were no churches. There were no synagogues, if you want to go that route. There was no prophets that we know about.
We can only speculate.
Yeah. Okay, and how would you speculate? Did angels come to visit him?
Possibly.
Maybe.
Probably his conversations, however those happened with God.
Both.
We know that God spoke directly to Adam and Eve. Mm-hmm. We know that he spoke to Moses at the burning bush, certainly, and in the mountain, and other
times. What about Abraham?
Abraham argued with
What about God. Enoch?
He walked with him.
How does God decide that he should make a personal appearance to some human being?
I suspect that he tries to do it to everyone. And some of us allow it, and some of us just reject him.
Let me ask you a question I've asked before in different settings. Would you like to have maybe a half an hour conference with God every week?
Sure. Absolutely. Yeah.
Who do you think would demand equal time?
Lucifer and all these.
How would you like to have a half an hour conversation with the devil every week?
And then the devil might try to make it difficult to determine who you're with. Do I believe this one because of who it is, or?
Well, we have mentioned this before, but this is, I think, the quintessential example. What happened to the disciples between Crucifixion Friday and 2 days later when they started hearing rumors about an empty tomb, and then, 48 days later or something, 49 days later, at Pentecost, and then after that?
They grew up.
They grew up.
A life after death became reality.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And a lot of what Christ had told them fell into place.
Right.
And certainly with the eunuch and the...
Philip?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Got baptized, and that got around too.
Well, we're told that the Holy Spirit descended upon them. What does that mean?
Just what it said.
Just what it says?
They even got tongues of light there, didn't they?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it says that he ascended on high and gave gifts to man, and we speak of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, those the gifts of prophecy and apostleship and healings and tongues and so forth and so on. But at the end of John, after his resurrection, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." So there was, in a measure, they had already received the Spirit to prepare them for the final outpouring.
Well, okay. So just think about these two different perspectives. One group of people says, this life is all there is. When you die, you're dead a long time. The other group of people says, this life is just the beginning. It's just a brief period of time in which we prepare ourselves for the rest of eternity. How different would that make you feel about things?
Very.
Very much, I mean, so, yeah.
Everything in this life would look different without the understanding of life after death.
So now going to the story of Job. One thing for sure about Job is that he didn't fade and wilt under the blistering and untrue words spoken by his so-called friends. In fact, he felt quite capable of giving it back to them just about as strong as they gave it to him, right? So how did he respond to the speeches of Bildad and Zophar? Look at Job 12, starting with verse 1. And here's, "Yes, you are the voice of the people." I can see him. "When you die, wisdom will die with you." Obviously, tongue in cheek, a little sarcasm. "But I have as much sense as you have. I am in no way inferior to you. Everyone knows all that you have said." So what have they said to him? Everyone knows, Job, that people don't suffer unless they're terrible sinners, right? Now what does he say? "Everyone knows all that you have said. Even my friends laugh at me now. They laugh although I'm righteous and blameless. But there was a time when God answered my prayers." Oh boy. "You have no troubles, and yet you make fun of me. You hit someone who is about to fall. But thieves and godless people live in peace, though their only God is their own strength. Even birds and animals have much they could teach you. Ask the creatures of earth and see for their wisdom. All of them know that the Lord's hand made them. It is God who directs the lives of his creatures. Everyone's life is in his power. But just as your tongue enjoys tasting food, your ears enjoy hearing words. Old people have wisdom, but God has wisdom and power. Old people have insight. God has insight and power to act. When God tears down, who can rebuild and who can free those God imprisons? Drought comes when God withholds rain. Floods come when he turns water loose. God is strong and always victorious. Both deceived and deceiver are in his power. He takes away the wisdom of rulers and makes leaders act like fools. He dethrones kings and makes them prisoners. He humbles priests and men of war. He silences those who are trusted and takes the wisdom of old people away. He disgraces those in power and puts an end to the strength of rulers. He sends light to places dark as death. He makes nations strong and great, but then he defeats and destroys them. He makes their leaders foolish and lets them wander confused and lost. They grope in the dark and stagger like drunkards. Everything you say, I've heard before. I understand it all. I know as much as you do. I'm not your inferior. But my dispute is with God, not you. I want to argue my case with him. So what's he saying?
You guys aren't helping me much.
You guys aren't helping me very much, that's for sure. So
I want to talk to God.
Okay. "You cover up your ignorance with lies," he goes on to say. "You are like doctors who can't heal anyone. Say nothing, and someone may think you are wise. Listen while I state my case. Why are you lying? Do you think your lies will benefit God?" What did they think they were doing? What did Job's friends think they were doing?
They were defending God.
They thought they were defending God. Are you trying to defend him? Are you going to argue his case in court? If God looks at you closely, will he find anything good? I'm sorry, I have to laugh. Do you think you can fool God as you fool others? Even though your prejudice is hidden, he will reprimand you, and his power will fill you with terror. Your proverbs are as useless as ashes. Your arguments are crumbled like clay. Be quiet and give me a chance to speak, and let the results be what they will. I'm ready to risk my life. I've lost all hope. So what if God kills me? I'm going to state my case to him. It may even be that my boldness will save me, since no wicked person would dare face God. What's he trying to say there?
That he deserves a right to bring his case to God, and
well, and
that he would be able to stand before God because he can't see any he's not a wicked person, so he
we would presume he's had a lot of conversations with God already. Well, he's not uncomfortable with God. Now listen to my words of explanation. I am ready to state my case because I know I am in the right. Are you coming to accuse me, God? If you do, I'm ready to be silent and die. Let me ask for two things, agree to them, and I will not try to hide from you. Stop punishing me. Don't crush me with terror. Speak first, O God, and I will answer, or let me speak and you answer me. What are my sins? What wrongs have I done? What crimes am I charged with? Why do you avoid me? Why do you treat me like an enemy? Are you trying to frighten me? I'm nothing but a leaf. You're attacking a piece of dry straw. You bring bitter charges against me, even for what I did when I was young. You bind chains on my feet. You watch every step I take and even examine my footprints. As a result, I crumble like rotten wood, like a moth-eaten coat. Do you agree with his words?
Say yes or no, but in 26 where it says, you bring bitter charges against me for what I did when I was young. What is...
Well, he's saying, I'm a sinner. I'm not trying to pretend that I was never a sinner.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, do we have any false conceptions of God?
Oh, the things we are going
to... We see through a glass darkly.
Yeah.
We know
yeah.
in part, we prophesy in part.
Would God bless us to spread those false ideas about him to others? Was God blessing Job's friends and their accusations of him? Maybe that's one of the reasons why he has not come back yet. Is that why our message is not spreading faster?
Is it possible that we in this room don't even have the right message?
Wow. How could that be? Well, now, we suggested, and I think, two lessons back or something like that, I challenged you to look for things about which Job and his friends disagreed. There's a lot of things about which they agreed, but we're going to look for things about which they disagreed. Can you think, in this speech here, can you see some things about which Job and his friends disagreed? Well, they thought they were defending God by their words. Job clearly thinks he's defending God by his words. Right?
Mm-hmm. Well, he's saying they're lying. What were they lying about?
That's the question.
Mm-hmm. I know. I'm hoping to find the answer without having to work too hard here.
Well, there were a number of things about which they agreed, but then there are some things about which they clearly disagreed. Their lies about God were one area of clear disagreement with Job's defense of God. And remember Job 42:7-8, which we're going to eventually get to. After the Lord had finished speaking to Job, he said to Eliphaz, I am angry with you and your two friends because you did not speak the truth about me as my servant Job did. Now take 7 bulls and 7 rams to Job and offer them as a sacrifice for yourselves. Job will pray for you and I will answer his prayer and not disgrace you as you deserve. You did not speak the truth about me as he did. So, is this one of the places where Job is speaking the truth about God and they are not speaking the truth about God?
Sound that way.
So, they're saying... And we're going to see this is going to get even more serious. They're starting to say, you know, you got to be careful. This God is powerful. You can't talk to him. And Job says, yes, I can. I would like to talk to God. Is that a difference? Is that a separation between the two sides? I think so.
Like the one who hid his talent in the ground because I knew you were a hard man, you know. In other words, his concept of the master was distorted.
Mm-hmm.
Here their concept of God is distorted also, that he's unapproachable.
Do you think that you know God well enough so that if you had to go through an experience like Job's, God would be able to say about you, he or she has said of me what is right? Could you clearly delineate, spell out the errors that other people are speaking about God? Is it clear in your mind?
Sometimes the differences are very subtle.
Mm-hmm. Well, as we read through the book of Job, starting with Job 1 and 2 and ending with Job 42, we should see a bit of a silver lining to these clouds. But remember that in our discussions, we have to be honest and realize that neither Job nor his three friends knew about Job 1 and 2 and Job 42 as they were having their conversations, right? But as Job begins to digest what his friends have said, and as he thinks things through for himself, he begins to see the glimmers of hope as he formulated answers to his friends. Now, what were some of those answers? Look at Job 13, verse 15. I've lost all hope, so what if God kills me? I'm going to state my case to him. It may even be that my boldness will save me, since no wicked person would dare to face God. Now, there's an interesting conundrum here, if you know some of the original language. There are actually two different versions of that verse in the ancient manuscripts. One Hebrew expression suggests, even if he should kill me, I will trust him. And that's what most of our versions have. But that a few versions, like the New Revised Standard Version and the New Living Translation, take the other Hebrew expression and translate, see, he will kill me. I have no hope. Does that fit better with Job's thinking at that point, do you think? Or which one of those two things do you think fits better with the rest of the arguments in this context?
First one.
Yeah, I think the first one. It seems to make more sense. Ellen White commented, the riches of the grace of Christ must be kept before the mind. Treasure up the lessons that his love provides. Let your faith be like Job's, that you may declare, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. Job 13:15. Lay hold on the promises of your heavenly Father and remember his former dealings with you and with his servants. For all things work together for good to them that love God. Now we know that even that's not a correct rendering of Romans 8:28. In the earliest manuscripts, the word for God occurs earlier in this sentence, so it really should read, in all things God works for good to those who love him. Does that make better sense to you? In all things God works for good?
Even in the trials of Job.
Mm-hmm. Well, Job recognized, and we need to recognize, that from a purely human perspective, there were not much reason for hope. As he was going through this experience, it really looked like he was going to die.
And he wished he could.
And he at least expressly wished that he might be able to. But knowing God, he realized that there is more than what might appear here on this earth. So what about us? From a purely human perspective, how much hope do we have? Of course, we've got Job 1 and 2, and we've got Job 42, and we have the rest of scriptures. We know about the story of Christ. We should have plenty of reasons for hope, right? Look at a couple of verses for comparison. Job 1:1. There was a man named Job living in the land of Uz who worshiped God and was faithful to him. He was a good man, careful not to do anything evil. Okay? And compare James 2:20-22. You fool, do you want to be shown that faith without actions is useless? How was our ancestor Abraham put right with God? It was through his actions when he offered his son Isaac on the altar. Can't you see his faith and his actions worked together? His faith was made perfect through his actions. So what is that implying about Job?
His faith was working with his actions. He was.
And what does he say?
Will.
Later on, and I'm sorry, we probably should have mentioned these verses a little bit earlier, perhaps, but later on we're going to find they accused Job of doing all sorts of awful things, and Job says, no, I fed the widows, I helped the orphans, I did all these things. So his faith was actually working. Does that give us a clue about how Job developed his faith? Well,
he had a practical faith.
Going back now to Job 13, verses 14 to 16. I am ready to risk my life, Job says. I've lost all hope, so what if God kills me? I'm going to state my case to him. It may even be that my boldness will save me, since no wicked person would dare to face God. What's he trying to say? He's responding actually to his own words, isn't he?
He's reasoned it out and figures even if he dies, he's not afraid to ask God why.
I know of a friend who one time was woken up in the middle of the night, a pastor. But somebody's banging on his door. He went to the door. The guy pushed his way into the house with the gun, put it to his head, and started asking him, do you believe in God, and so forth like that, those kind of questions. He says, well, first of all, he asked a bunch of questions with the gun down. He said, line up your family over there. So he called his family out and lined them up against the wall. He said, I'm going to ask you questions. Do you believe in God? Do you believe Jesus is coming back again? Those kinds of questions. And the pastor, of course, said, yes, yes, yes. And so then the man took his gun and put it right to his forehead like this, and he says, okay, I'm going to ask you the same questions, and the first time you say yes, I'm going to pull the trigger. And his family is over there watching. What would you do?
It's the same situation, you know. You have to answer, risking the fact that you may die, but state the truth.
Well, this guy said yes, and the guy started shaking and threw his gun across the room. He says, I didn't believe there was anyone left in the world who really believed anything. Well, did Job know about times when God actually killed some human beings? Did he know about the flood? Did he know about Sodom and Gomorrah? We don't really know. He must have known about the flood. Surely he must have lived after the flood. But what about Sodom and Gomorrah? We just don't know. Remember, Sodom and Gomorrah happened to go during whose time?
Abraham's.
So it was quite a ways back there, wasn't it? Well, if you believe you're facing an imminent death, what else could bring any hope? You've got to hope that there's something beyond death, right? Yeah. To the Christian who clearly understands the biblical teaching about death as a dreamless sleep followed by a resurrection, which to that person seems instantaneous, and then to arise at the second coming of Jesus Christ, what a hope. I remember just not very long ago now, my father died. And you think, okay, he's been suffering. He gradually got less and less responsive. He wouldn't respond to us hardly at all. And then he just stopped breathing. And you think, okay, the next thing he sees and knows will be the second coming of Jesus Christ. And of course, you're standing there, you're thinking, take another breath, take another breath. Well, remember Paul's discussion about the resurrection in 1 Corinthians 15, 11 to 20? Let's just read that for a moment. So here's Paul. He's discussing with the Corinthians, who have lots of questions, lots of crazy things going on in their minds. And he says, so then, whether it came from me or from them, this is what we all preach, and this is what you believe. So he's talking about the resurrection. Now, since our message is that Christ has been raised from death, that's our Christian message, how can some of you say that the dead will not be raised to life? If that is true, it means that Christ was not raised, And if Christ has not been raised from death, then we have nothing to preach and you have nothing to believe. More than that, we are shown to be lying about God because we said that he raised Christ from death. But if it is true that the dead are not raised to life, then he did not raise Christ. For if the dead are not raised, then neither has Christ been raised. So if the resurrection is not true, then God is a liar. What we're preaching is false. It would also mean that the believers in Christ who have died are lost. And then these key verses, 19 to 20, if our hope in Christ is good for this life only and no more, then we deserve more pity than anyone else in all the world. But the truth is that Christ has been raised from death as the guarantee that those who sleep in death will also be raised. Would that give you hope?
Yep.
Definitely.
Well, in the first chapter of Job, we found out that Job did what for his children when they were partying?
Offered sacrifices.
Right. Maybe they were partying too hard, so better offer a sacrifice for them, right? But think of, if he's offering a sacrifice to pay for, for the benefit of his children, in the possibility that they might have done something wrong. What do you think he understood those sacrifices to symbolize? And today, what do we believe those sacrifices symbolized in the Old Testament?
Jesus.
Okay.
The death of Jesus.
Okay. Of course, we now live hundreds of years after the crucifixion and the resurrection. Do we clearly understand why Jesus had to die and the implications of the resurrection? Could you make a resounding statement of faith and hope similar to the one made by Job? What do you think?
If you take the word clearly out, maybe.
I want you to make a clear statement. Well, we know about the fall of Adam and Eve as pictured in Genesis 3. We also know about the final scenes in this earth's history, at least from a prophetic viewpoint as pictured in the book of Revelation. Do you see any hope in those two chapters, Genesis 3 and Revelation 14? What does it say in Genesis 3?
Thou shalt bruise his heel and...
And he's speaking to the serpent.
Yeah. And
he will bruise your head and you will bruise his heel, right? What does it say in Revelation 14? Oh, I should say the whole last half of Revelation. What does it say? Promises?
Promises about what's happening to God's people. Come out of my people. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according to his works.
There's some very interesting words from Ellen White, and then I'm going to see if we can go back and apply those to the Bible. This is Desire of Ages, page 210, paragraph 2. The world has been committed to Christ, and through him has come every blessing from God to the fallen race. He was the Redeemer before as after his incarnation. As soon as there was sin, there was a Savior. What does that mean? I mean, who was the Savior? Jesus, right? We don't have any question about that. There are many Christians, even among Seventh-day Adventists, who have serious questions about God's foreknowledge. So I'm going to read you a few verses and see what you learn from these verses. I'm going to turn first to Ephesians 1, verse 4. Even before the world was made, God had already chosen us to be his through our union with Christ, so that we would be holy and without fault before him. Could that be true if God did not have foreknowledge? Well, let's try another verse. Titus 1, 2, which is based on the hope for eternal life. God, who does not lie, promised us this life before the beginning of time. Would that be possible if God didn't have foreknowledge? 2 Timothy 1, 8 and 9. Do not be ashamed then of witnessing for our Lord, nor be ashamed of me as a prisoner for Christ's sake. Instead, take your part in suffering for the good news as God gives you the strength to do it. He saved us and called us to be his own people, not because of what we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. He gave us the grace by means of Christ Jesus before the beginning of time. Okay, and then 1 Peter 1, 18 to 20. For you know what was paid to set you free from the worthless manner of life handed down by your ancestors. It was not something that can be destroyed, such as silver and gold. It was the costly sacrifice of Christ, who was like a lamb without defect or flaw. And, of course, it's talking about the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Are those verses enough reason for us to believe that God has foreknowledge? Before the beginning of time, before creation, he made provision for our salvation. So what's our hope based on today? Well, here's a list. As Christians, we have so much to hope for and to hope in. This is from our Bible study guide. This is actually from for Wednesday, November 23. As Christians, we have so much to hope for and to hope in. We exist in a universe created by God who loves us, John 3:16. A God who redeemed us, Titus 2:14. A God who hears our prayers, Matthew 6, verse 6. A God who intercedes for us, Hebrews 7:25. A God who promises never to forsake us, Hebrews 13, verse 5. A God who promises to raise our bodies from death, Isaiah 26:19, and to give us eternal life with him, John 14:2 and 3. Does that give us some reason for hope? Well, maybe I should put it this way. Which of those promises gives you the most hope? You want to review them again?
Well, his love. I think you can say what you will about promises. Anyone can promise something, mm-hmm. but when we experience his love and know that he cares for us, then that gives us hope, I think. Mm-hmm. And if we see that he has the power to bring about things, then that also would give us hope. He raised Jesus from the dead, so therefore he can raise us, as Paul argues.
Why is it necessary for Jesus to plead for us?
Or is it?
Is the Father not very forgiving? Well, some people think there needs to be a lot of pleading going on. Roman Catholics believe they need a lot of saints pleading for them. They pray to the saints, and the saints plead with Mary, and Mary pleads with Jesus, and Jesus pleads with the Father. And do we need all that?
There's only one mediator between man and God, and that's the man Jesus Christ. So he's the one that stands between us and the Father.
Okay.
It was said that no one can see God and live. So there's something about being in his presence or seeing him as Adam and Eve were capable of, other unfallen beings that would kill us. Mm-hmm. So he's the one who stands between us, not because God wants to kill us, but because it would just...
If we were exposed to his glory...
It's just the state of things, and God wants to come close, so he's using Jesus to do so.
One of the pages, I think it's Thursday in our Bible study guide for this week, has a whole list of verses, and it asks you to look them up and see what kind of a progression you see in these verses. So I did the homework for you, and I picked out what I thought was the key words in those passages, and let's look at it. Genesis 3:15. Satan and evil will be crushed. Genesis 22:8, God will provide a sacrifice in that case. Leviticus 17:11, our sins can be taken away. John 1:29, the Lamb of God takes away the sin of the world. Galatians 2:16, by faith in God we can be put right with Him. Philippians 1:6, God will finish this good work in us. 1 Corinthians 10:13, He will not allow you to be tested beyond your power to remain firm. At the time you are put to the test, He will give you the strength to endure it and so provide you with a way out. Daniel 7:22, God's people will receive royal power. Daniel 12:1 and 2, when that time comes, all the people of your nation whose names are written in God's book will be saved. Matthew 24:27, the Son of Man will come like the lightning which flashes across the whole sky. And Daniel 2, verse 44, the God of heaven will establish a kingdom that will never end. So what kind of a sequence do you see there? Does that give us reasons for hope?
Yes.
It covers most of the parameters.
Mm-hmm. Well, is there any questions in your mind about whether or not the Bible is full of hope? If there's a whole bunch of more verses. The lesson just gives you verses. John 16:33 and Matthew 28:20, Galatians 3:13, Psalm 103:12, Romans 8:38 and 39, Genesis 9:16, 1 John 3:1, Psalm 100, verse 3. I mean, it just goes on. I picked out one of those verses that I especially like. This used to be my favorite verse in the whole Bible. Maybe it still is. I'm not quite sure. I have so many ones I like. Romans 8:38 and 39, my Good News Bible says, for I am certain that nothing can separate us from His love, neither death, nor life, nor either angels, nor other heavenly beings, rulers, or powers, neither the present, nor the future, neither the world above, nor the world below. There is nothing in all creation that will ever be able to separate us from the love of God, which is ours, through Christ Jesus our Lord. What is the world below? The Jews had the idea that when you die and you're buried, you now enter a lower world. And some of them believed that Satan was in charge of that lower world. Well, of course, these verses said, you don't have to worry about that. Nothing, absolutely nothing, no whether you're alive or dead or anything, can separate you from God's love. Well, as you think over the fundamental beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, which of them especially give you hope?
Second coming.
The second coming, okay. Anybody else? I, and maybe this is because of all my experiences over the years, but I am really excited about our understanding of the Great Controversy, because it makes it possible for me to put the whole thing together and make sense out of it. I don't have to say, well, I'm not sure why God did that. I'm not sure why God did this. I'm not sure why He did this. No, at all, I really believe I can put it all together in light of the Great Controversy. Ellen White says in a letter she wrote to the wife of a church leader in Australia in 1906, talk hope and faith and thanksgiving to God. Be cheerful, hopeful in Christ. Educate yourself to praise Him. This is a great remedy for diseases of the soul and of the body. So, how does that work, Gordon? Have you treated anybody who have diseases of the soul?
I have not given a prescription for hope and faith.
Maybe we should do that. Maybe we should write it out.
Maybe I have given some hope and faith to some people.
I hope so.
And some thanksgiving that they don't have something worse, but...
Yeah. Well, we have suggested, and even in the last couple of lessons, that some of the experiences of Job seem to match some of the experiences of Christ, especially in the final events of His life, and again, match some of the events we expect to take place at the end of this world, connected to the 144,000. So what does the suffering and death of Jesus tell us about each of those events? Job, Christ, Second Coming. And we don't, and I'm not asking you to give a whole litany of things about, but I mean, clearly we see the death and the resurrection of Jesus as the centerpiece for our beliefs, don't we? What is it especially about that that gives you hope? The death and resurrection of Jesus. Let's focus just on that.
That we can be raised also.
Absolutely.
Did in Christ arise first.
Mm-hmm.
We gathered up with them.
Well, we have suggested that the experiences of Job match in some ways those things, okay? Our Bible study guide quotes James 2:20-22. We already read that. The experience of Abraham several times. Do you see a relationship between these verses about faith and action works and the story of Job? Now, how much do we know about Job's actions?
Just what he has said.
Not too much where it's actually demonstrated. We just have his words for it. But we haven't even got to those yet. Would you say that there was anything about the story of Job so far that proves Job's faith is active?
Well, he sacrificed for his children.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is, of course, just talking, but he opposes wrong ideas that are proposed by his friends. Are there things that we could learn from Job's friends?
Maybe think before you speak.
Think before you speak, okay. Are the things we should, yes, Gordon.
I think we can learn that we may think we're right and we're dead wrong.
You come on now, you think that could happen to us?
I think it does.
Wow.
It may have even happened to me recently.
Oh dear. If we read carefully through the speeches of Bildad and Zophar as well as Job's responses, do you see any sudden glimpses of light in certain places? Let you out there think about that. We do not need to be told that the tongue is a powerful instrument. It can be a way of bringing hope, or it can be a terribly destructive weapon. Do you think Job's friends learned anything from everything that happened? Did any of them ever realize that they were not representing God correctly?
When they had to go and give sacrifices to Job, they might have figured it out. I'm not sure.
Well, that's the question is, did they go home puzzled about those Job 42, 7, and 8? What do you think?
I hope not.
Maybe they had a reunion a year later. What did we learn a year ago? We've had conferences on what did we learn in 1888, and apparently not much.
Well, they would have Job's words and God's words to meditate on as they went home.
Well, I don't want to take the thunder out of Job 42, but let me read these words. All Job's brothers and sisters and former friends, now does that include the three, came to visit him and feasted with him in his house. This is after his, of course, his health and everything has been restored. They expressed their sympathy and comforted him for all the troubles the Lord had brought on him.
Yeah.
Did they learn anything?
Monotheism.
Well, they're acknowledging God's control over all, that he allowed it. Whether he directly did it or allowed it, he's in control. So,
and there's the handout. If God didn't do it, who did?
Yeah. Well, human groups, including Seventh-day Adventist churches, are not immune from indulging in gossip, critical comments, even slander. Any close-knit group that shares more than a few details of each other's lives, and that would certainly include families, risks the possibility of falling into chit-chat, backbiting, even gossip. What does the Bible say about gossips?
In the same list as murderers.
They're right in the middle of the longest list of sinners in the whole Bible, Romans 1. Gossips. What's so wrong with gossip?
You misrepresent sometimes the truth.
You're not expressing love for the person. You're just trying to get attention because you know something that somebody else doesn't know. So you're drawing attention to yourself and your knowledge rather than trying to minister to the needs of that person.
A father once said to his children, there are two things you cannot take back, a launched arrow and a spoken word. How often do we speak words that we wish we could take back?
Way too often.
I have a patient, bless his soul, that comes in the slightest little thing, and he flies off the handle, and he's cussing and swearing at the ladies at the front desk and so forth, and they have to call out the security. And we had crazy experiences last week because we have a new one of our new security guards came charging out there to see what was going on. And he looked at this guy, and this guy used to be his employer. And later he said to us, He does have a little problem with anger.
Yeah,
just a little.
And then when I show up, often they have to call me out to the front desk. Oh, he's so doc, please could you help me? He's so apologetic. And do we ever say things without carefully thinking about what we are about to say? Have we ever wounded close members of the family or friends? Have you ever said something to somebody and you wish you hadn't, and you just wish that everybody would forget it, and unfortunately that person mentions it to you years later?
Is that kind of like the saying, engage brain before speaking?
Something like that. Yeah. Proverbs 25:11 says, an idea well expressed is like a design of gold set in silver. Now maybe that's the way our words should be, right? While we have spoken about the potentially negative impact of words, it is also possible to realize the hope-inspiring impact of a good word spoken at the right time. Remember Genesis 3:15 again? It is interesting to note that the word seed, the Hebrew word for seed, referring to the seed of the woman, is in the singular, referring to Jesus Christ, the Anointed One, as the Messiah. He was hurt by Satan, that is, his heels were bruised, but by living the life which he lived, dying the death which he died, and arising on resurrection morning as he did, he destroyed Satan's kingdom. And I would ask you again, just quickly, how do you destroy Satan's kingdom? What do you need to do to destroy Satan's kingdom?
Show it for what it is.
Okay. Another way of saying that is, if Satan's kingdom is built on lies, how do you destroy it?
Tell the truth.
Tell the truth. Yeah. Well, how do you feel about Job's response in Job 12 and 13 to Zophar's and Bildad's speeches? How do you think they felt as they listened to Job saying things like, your proverbs are as useless as ashes. Your arguments crumble like clay. But we have to remember that in the latter part of Job 13, after addressing his friends, we've already talked about this, he turned to address God. And he reaches out. Now, his words aren't always really friendly, but he reaches out. He's longing for a response from God. Now, we haven't got to Elihu yet, later in the book of Job, Job 37, verse 4, and he says, I wouldn't ask to speak with God. I wouldn't give him a chance to kill me, to destroy me. So there's another way in which Job wants to talk to God, and his friends are saying, stand back away. be careful here. Who are we calling on here? Well, Our lesson speaks about a stubborn hope. What's a stubborn hope?
A hope that won't die.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you think of some people who had a stubborn hope? In the Bible, even?
I've often wondered if Sarah had a stubborn hope.
Yeah. Well, yeah, exactly. Especially after she started having stopped having periods, yeah. Huh? Well, look at Genesis 22:8. Here they are. He's with Isaac. They're walking up the final hill to the top of Mount Moriah. They have the wood. They have the fire. And Isaac says, "Where's the lamb?" Now, you wonder why that question wasn't asked a long time sooner. But what did Abraham say?
God will provide.
God will provide. Think about Daniel 3:16 and 17. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, what were they doing? They're standing in front of Nebuchadnezzar, who could have had their heads cut off just if he just said so. And what do they say to him? "Your Majesty, we will not try to defend ourselves. If the God whom we serve is able to save us from the blazing furnace and from your power, then he will. But even if he doesn't, Your Majesty, may be sure that we will not worship your God, and we will not bow down to the gold statue that you have set up." Wow. Would you dare to say that to a Nebuchadnezzar? I've already looked at James 2:20 and 1 Corinthians 15. Think of Daniel's three friends. Wow. We will see that Job spoke more and more about the hope in contrast to the speeches of his friends until his words recorded in Job 19:25-27. Let me read that as we conclude. "But I know there is someone in heaven who will come at last to my defense. Even after my skin is eaten by disease," and it was already being eaten by disease, "while still in this body, I will see God. I will see him with my own eyes, and he will not be a stranger." What does that tell us? What condition do you think Job expected to be in as he saw God? Well, we're running out of time. Our lesson talks about hypocrites. It talks about people who were claiming to be doing something and then they weren't. Certainly, Job's three friends ended up being hypocrites. Let's not do that ourselves. Our kind and loving Father, we thank you for these opportunities we have to worship you and to serve you, to speak about you, hopefully speaking the truth about you. These lessons can be challenging, but they reveal a lot of really important points, and we're thankful for them. In Jesus' name, amen.